coming every day, and it's a dream. So yeah, I'm definitely happy.
What was little Curtis like?
Don't know if I can even say this on camera. Steven was the one who made me really think, look, if I lock all the way in, now I can go to the top. I don't need to go out on loan. I don't need to go and leave the club. And I'm good enough.
Tell us about Everton then, FA Cup.
The only thing I had in my head is I'm going to score.
Curtis, great to see you, and thanks for spending some time with us.
No, thank you for having me, of course. It's good to be alongside the legend himself. So yeah, I'm happy to be here and let's see what the question you got for me.
Yeah, well, listen, the first one I think we were all thinking of was that there must be few people that's just enjoying life like you are at the moment. It's everything you dreamed of, it's everything you've worked your entire life for, and Liverpool's first team.
Yeah, I mean, you've hit it there on the edge, you know. I come in every day, and it's a dream. I've always got a smile on my face. So you see me all the time, and now the training pitches and stuff, and after the games, you're saying, you know, I'm a Scouser. It was always my dream to play here. And yet I'm here now in the first team. I'm a part of the team. I have been now since I was around about 17. The journey's not been easy, but I'm one of them. I'd buy into the whole the thing, and that's what I've done. And I'm sat here today on over 100 games. So I say that with a smile on my face. So yeah, I'm definitely happy.
Because they always used to say, didn't they, the academy staff, come back here when you've played 50 games. Yeah, it seemed such a big journey, whereas you've doubled that already.
Yeah, definitely. Alex Ingerthorpe actually always said, he doesn't normally say that you're a first teamer official until you've played 100 games. And if you're telling a kid 100 games, wow, that's so many games. And I'm saying there, you know, I've been around the first team since I was 17. I'm 22 now, and you know, I've only just hit 100 games. So that obviously shows, you know, the journey that I've had has not been easy. I've been off the team for injuries and change of the squad and different things. But, you know, I've always overcame it. And yet I'm here now on 100 plus.
You mentioned it's a difficult journey. You mentioned your injuries. That's obviously one thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
But what were the sporting sort of hurdles you had to overcome?
A big one, I'd say, was always, so from the academy time, I'd always been a kid to jump up the age group. So I was 15, I played with the 16s. So I was 16, I was with the 18s. Then obviously I was around the first team, I was 17. So it's always been a successful journey, I'd say. I come around the first team and I kind of felt a little bit of like a stop. So like what do I need to do next? So you know, I was training every week, but then you know, I'd come at the end of the week and then I'd be out of the squad. And other players, you know, who've always been in a team since I've came round, always been global stars, and obviously had played 400, 500 plus games over me. So I always knew it was gonna be hard. But it kind of felt like I was just training all the time, and I wouldn't say a reward weren't there, because you know, I was training every day, but as a player yourself, you know, like you're training every week because of the game at the weekend. So you know, you've always got a smile on your face, and you know, okay, I'm training now, it's hard, but at least at the end of the week we've got a game. So the end of the week would come, and you know, the amount of times that then I'd check the list and weren't in the squad or different things, like I wouldn't be traveling down and stuff, you know, with the team. So I was around that stage for a long time, and then of course then you know the team and that then would be changed around. So there'd be times then I'd go and play and I was doing well, but then say tactically then we had changed for a different team and I was out the team again and things like that. So you know, it's been hard, but it's all part of the game, and I go back to it all the time and say, you know what actually helped me, the time that I had when I was out actually helped me mature in a lot of ways. I changed my game a lot, I changed as a lad, and I'm here now, and I definitely think that the time when, you know, I spent off the pitch, I think that was a big part of it.
Was that something you dealt with on your own, or did you have people you turned to? I mean, I'm talking about maybe some teammates, experienced teammates,
yeah,
or even the coaching staff.
A bit of all three, if I'm honest. You know, the players that were around me when I first came around was the likes of Milner, Henderson, Lallana, Juan Alden played a big part. Trent himself has also played a part. Because they've all been kids themselves, they've all came in a team to where, you know, they've not played and they've been part of a squad to where they've been the young kid and the exciting kid who's coming in. But they also know at the same time as how much hard work that they've had to do. So, you know, they always knew I was a kid, I just loved to play. So they also knew at the same time, if I didn't play, I'm not going to be a kid. Oh, I'm happy just to be here. I am, but at the same time, I want to go and play. So, you know, they always had their arm around me and they was helping me out a lot. And then in the managing, the staff were always great. They always said, look, you're young, you've still got time, you're doing well. And then, of course, I was allowed to go and play in the academy and go and still play games. And then just family and friends as well played a big part. They always spoke about my journey and where I'd came from and how far I'd got. And you always, like a kid like you, who's come from, and the upbringing was always hard. They always said, like, we always know that it's always in there. So, you know, you're not a kid, you will quit, you'll always stick to it. And I think I'm doing well at the minute.
I just want to pick up on one thing you said. I've always been a kid who wanted to play.
Yeah.
And I guess that's what took you too close to the first team. Does that then become a weakness in that all you really want to do? Because that's how you got introduced to the first team. When I first saw you, I thought, well, here we got a kid, he wants to be on the ball, he wants to do assists and scoring goals or whatever. And then to be part of one of the strongest midfields in the world, I guess you have to make some changes to the way that you want to play.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, they're just saying, I'd always been a kid who just wanted to come in and just get on the ball and score goals and assist and run with the ball, because that's what I'd always did. And then you come around the first team and it's a massive change. You know, the lads are quicker, they're stronger, they think better and stuff like that. So, you know, you kind of got to change your whole game. But the biggest thing that I was always taught of the managing the staff and even, you know, the lads as well, was always the player that you are is not the same as me. So you don't actually need to change your game to try and play like me, just because I'm playing in the first team. You know what I mean? I've always got my own way of playing. So basically just be yourself, but mature in like certain ways, and that's what I always do.
Change is a big thing. You're definitely different this year.
Yeah.
Just the more time I spend around you, it feels like we're not talking about Curtis Jones, the kid that's made good anymore. You feel and sound like a senior player now.
Yeah, I feel it, and I'm trying to sound like it as well. I mean, definitely. I think, you know, there's been a huge change in the team. And I'm one of the ones who's been here. It's mad to say, you know, I'm only 22. So, yeah, even though I'm young, I do feel like I'm one of the experienced ones and know how the manager and staff like to go and play. And, you know, he's spoke about it a lot, the way I'm the first one to go and press and things like that. Now, you know, I was a kid who came in and pressing and defending was never a thing for me. I don't need that part of the game. And now that he's picking up on it loads and he spoke about it, just goes to show how much that I've actually changed.
And it's noticeable too when you watch young kids train or young kids play now, Callum Scanlon making his debut, you noticeably going over to him saying, you know, settle on the ball a little bit. Troy Naione, who was training with the first team, you're the first over to speak to him.
Yeah.
You know how those experiences feel.
Yeah, definitely. Again, as I'll always say, I've been there before. I've been the kid who's come in and I'm just excited, just give me the ball, I just want to go and run. And, you know, the older you get, the more games you play, you understand that, you know, you need to change your game, you need to do this and do that. But the one thing, you know, that I'll always tell the kids, I'll say, is you don't actually have to change your game. You just need to mature and understand the game more. So where Callum, you know, he likes to pick up the ball and run loads. You know, I'm not going to say to him, no, you can't do that. You can't. That's his game. I'm not going to make him change his game. But again, though, I was saying to him, look, we're 4-1 up here. We can control the game. You don't need to have the ball and just go and run. We can keep the ball a bit more and we can make them run. And the more that they run, the bigger the gaps will be. And then that's when you'll have your space. And that's what I was saying. He was doing it. And he took it on board. And the most important thing as well, though, I think as well as a kid, is like you've got to understand that when the seniors are on your back is to help you out. It's not as like a criticism or they want to see you do bad. You know, they're doing this because they know you've got the talent. And you want to see you just go and do well. And that's the thing that I learned as well. I came around the team and as I'm always saying, I just wanted to have the ball and just go and run and shoot and score. And a few of the lads were like, no, you need to keep the ball, do this and do that. And I'm thinking like, that's me though, you know what I mean? And the older I'd gone, the more I was around and the more I spoke with the senior lads, is I just realised, no, in fact, you know, they want me to go and do well. They see a kid who's got talent, he's got ability, and they want me to just go and get the best out of myself.
So the last 11 games last season, you came into the team the way you played, key figure.
Yeah.
Must have done a lot for you.
Yeah, it did, I think. I think in terms of the actual change was just before that, I was out for a long time. I think it was like 15 weeks or something I was out. So I just had a lot of time just to go and think. I was looking over my game a lot. I was seeing the bits that I was doing well and the bits that, you know, I could go and change. So I was kind of trying to adapt like the whole of my game. And then, yeah, I came in. The first game with Chelsea away. I think first game and Chelsea away, I haven't played for a while, it's going to be tough. But I handled it well. And then, I kept my place in the team. And then it just started to click. I think, you know, as yourself, is the biggest thing that you need as a player is to go and play. You know what I mean? If you're out of the team for a while and your fitness isn't there, or your touch is a little bit off and the rhythm and stuff isn't there, and because, you know, the starting team, they always go and play. So if you're coming in the team, you're not really up to speed, you know, it stands out a lot. So the biggest thing that, like, I always thought is, like, I just need to go and play. And I knew what I had to go and do. You know, I had to go in the team. I had to show, look, I'm ready. I'm not a kid anymore. At that time, I was almost on 100 games. So, you know, I had to go and show, yeah, look, I've got the experience. I've been out a while. The team weren't really in its best spell. I came in and I thought, do you know what? There's actually a chance if I go out there and I go and play well, I'll keep my place. And that's what I've done.
Is that the first time where you really felt, I've arrived now, this is my level?
Yeah, definitely. I say it all the time, is I've kind of been up and down. Just being fit and things around that have obviously played a part. But I'm somebody who doesn't want to make an excuse or anything like that. So yeah, as I said there, you know, I've been around the team since I was 17. Just being times when I've played like 3 games on a run, and then I'll come off the team and I won't play them for say 4 or 5 games, and I'll come off the bench. So it's like an up and down thing. But yeah, as you're saying there, I really feel that was the time when I was like, yeah, okay, fine. I've played 1 game, then I'm going to keep my place. I played 2, and then before I knew it, I'd finished it in the season on, what was it, 11 or 12 games on the spin. Obviously, I'd helped with goals and assists. So yeah, I really did think that was the part where I was like, okay, cool, this is the level now. You know, you want to show and show the game after game. This is where you're at, this is what you have to do.
Yeah, because if you look at it, I mean, you've been in terrific form for 6 months,
yeah,
apart from the VAR decision down at Spurs, isn't it? Everything else has gone really well, hasn't it?
Yeah.
And of course, you had a big summer.
Yeah.
How did you view that?
The summer, again, I feel that I'd done well because of the 12 games that I just went and had. On the back of there, where I'm coming into a team where I know, okay, I just went and played a lot of games, I'd scored, I assisted, there was a lot of talk about me. I can come here now where there's a tournament where there's all eyes on there. It's a tournament that the lads that are doing really, really well, but they're not quite there yet, I'd say, because they're not with like the senior team of the country and stuff. So like, I knew as well that I'm coming into a tournament where, you know, there's going to be lads that have got a name as well. So I really thought, okay, I can come here now and I can put down my mark. And I went there, I'd done that. At the end of the day, I had a fantastic team and staff around me that helped me out a lot. So I thanked them as well. But I went there and I done well. So yeah, it was a good tournament and a good 6 months.
What was little Curtis like? How would you look back and describe yourself as a...
What, the kid one?
Yeah, an 8-year-old.
Don't know if I can even say this on camera. No, I mean, listen.
Because they're always going to have a little bit of mischief about them kids, I think, that make it to the very top. You know, super well-behaved kids and, you know, high educational achievers don't always become top-level footballers.
Yeah, I mean, I was a cheeky kid, but respectful. You know what I mean? So I was always a kid who was like, anything I've done, I don't want to hear no. I just want to go and do it. Like, this is what I've chose to do. I want to go and do it. But at the end of the day, I feel that that's helped me now, because in the position that I was in, you know, it was a hard time, but I would never be told no. So, you know, you heard of lads who come around teams, but then they need loans, or they might need to leave the team to go and play over there and make the name, and then you can come back. But my biggest thing that I kept from the kid was just like, no, I don't need to go out on loan. I don't need to go and leave the club to go and have experience to go and play 100 games before I come back. Like, every single day I'm coming here, I'm training, and I know what I want, and that's what I'll go and do. So the 8-year-old kid me, yeah, like I just kept hold of that. But at the same time, was more like a respect as well, and like I understood, you know, I'm in a position where, when I was a kid, it's like the lads that I'd hang around all the time were always older than me. So, you know, I'm 8, but the lads that I'd hang around were always like 15 and 16 and that, and we'd always play on the streets. So I always knew it would be hard, so I'd be getting pushed around down the floor. Again, I would never quit, and that's just the same as I am now. So, like, I have matured a lot, but, like, I've always got that, like, same thing in my head to where, like, I can't be told no, but I understood, okay, yeah, the lad too ahead of me, senior lads that played 400-500 games. So, of course, they're ahead of me now, but I know what I've got to do to get ahead of them.
I was talking to one of the youth team coaches who said he remembers an 8-year-old Curtis playing against Barcelona in an international cup game with a Ronaldo haircut, best player in the tournament. You know, all of these things that get you to a level where then, a couple of years later, Steven Gerrard's a youth team coach, and I can remember him saying to me, watch this kid.
Yeah.
He'll go as far as he wants to go.
Nah, he helped me out loads. I say it now still, I feel like Steven was the one who came in and like, he made me really, really think, look, if I lock all the way in, now I can go to the top. I've always knew I've had the ability. But, you know, as a young kid, you're at the academy, and, you know, the staff are always on top of you, and they're always like, look, you can do this, you can do that, you're always going to play. And then at the same time, you know, all your mates and that are there as well. So you're coming in, and, like, you're doing well, but then you're also having a laugh. So you kind of not, you don't understand, though. If I do this and I do that, I'm not that far away from like, first team and that. And it was Steven, he was the one who really came in. And I forget the time, he was... We'd been away, I don't know what country it was, I think it was pre-season. And then we came back and he got to hold the team in on like a one-to-one. And he'd be speaking about the things that you've done well and how you need to improve. And I remember when I came in, I don't want to say what he said, but it was good, but it weren't nice.
Harsh truths.
Yeah, it was like the harsh truths. I say a little bit of how, like he said, look, I gave you the 10 shirts and that on your back because I want you to be my main lad and on the team, and I want to build a team around you, but you didn't show enough then. And it was a game that he said, and this is the thing that like stuck in my head a lot, to where I wanted to show him anything that you need from me, that I'll do it. It was a game that we had been beat, I think it was by Fulham. And apparently he said that I'd been tackled and the lad had stood over me and said something whilst I was on the floor, and he turned around, he said to me, and what did you do about it? And I was like, I can't remember. He said, well, I'll tell you, you done nothing. And I sat there and I thought, you know what, you're right, it's my club, there's people like you who've played your whole life here, and even came back to the academy, and now you're a coach and you want to give your all to the club. And there's people like me, you know, I'm a scout myself, but I don't understand it and the situation and stuff that I'm in. I need to grow up here, I need to be a man. And just after that, yeah, we just built like a connection to where I think he's seen, okay, he's willing here to go out there where, yeah, and we built a connection that wasn't always good, to where, you know, he was telling me often that, and you need to do this, you need to do that, but I took it on board and I done it. And that's why I say I think that he was a massive, massive part of it, because he weren't afraid to tell me when I was wrong, and at the same time he would say when I'm doing well, and yet he guarded me well. So
he was still texting you when you went on your first trip, wasn't he, with the first team?
Yeah,
he was still
yeah.
guiding, like, even though he was at a different club by then, he was at Rangers, their manager then.
Yeah, and I mean, that's what he's like. I just feel like he came in, it's like, you come in and you see him, and you think, oh my God, that's one of my idols, if not the man that I want to be, you know what I mean? He's a scout, he's come through, he's played his whole life here, his career's been unbelievable, he was captain and stuff, and I was looking at him and I was thinking, like, that's who I want to be. But he made it his business that I didn't think like that, and like, he done the same, like, the whole team. Like, when you call him, like, Gerard or anything like that, it was, I'm Steven, you know what I mean? I'm your coach. So it was like, even though he was me hard and I was coming in, I was like, wow, it was like, I'm coming in now, and he's my coach, and he will tell me off, and I might give him a bit back, and can't be afraid, you know what I mean? He's here to help me and get the most of the whole team, and that's what he did.
Was that the first time you realised it takes more than ability?
Yeah.
Because I guess that's what you're saying, isn't it?
Yeah.
Gerard prepared you mentally.
But he told me that as well.
Yeah, to be able to play for Liverpool, because I think everybody always knew you had the talent.
Yeah.
But you need a little bit more.
Yeah, well, again, yeah, he told me that same thing. He was like, look, is your ability and your talent is, I've not seen a lot of kids like that. He was like, but you get around the first team, that's not going to be enough. And I didn't really understand it at first until I came here and trained. And I played like me like first like training games. These lads were unbelievable, and I was coming in, and I was, you know, again, as I will say, I was a kid in the academy who was like, I was doing well all the time. I was jumping up the A's groups, and I was scoring like certain amounts of goals, and it was always easy. And then Steven came and he was like, look, it's not going to be enough. And I'd always had my mind frame on, well, I'm doing well here, I'll go with the first team, it's going to be the same. Until I got here and I thought, no, I need a massive, massive change. And again, I was willing to buy into it. I knew it wasn't going to be easy. I knew it was going to be a long run. But yeah, again, I'm sat here now in over 100 games. So I don't think I've done too bad. I still got a lot to learn. And every day that I come in, it's just a chance for me to learn and improve. And that's what I'm doing.
You talk about learning. How long does it actually take to fully understand what Jurgen Klopp wants from a midfield player?
I don't think it stops, if I'm honest. I don't think it stops. Okay, you've got a style of play, but it's a style of play for different teams that we're going to play. So we're not going to play the same as if City, we're not going to play the same as if then we're going to play who it can be, Wolves or someone like that. So I don't think it ever stops. And of course, then like your Champions League games or Europa League game will never ever change. The basics are there. In terms that, you know, okay, could you give away the ball, you go and press, you press as a team, as a counter pressing team on the ball, you know what you want, it's like a no risk, you can have your risk in like the final third and things like that. But again, it will always change just depending on the team anyway. So I feel the most important thing, you've got to learn the basics of what he wants and then gain his trust, and then it's on you then.
How's that relationship different with him than maybe it was with Steven? Because it was a wonderful insight into your relationship there. And it's never always going to be positive stuff, is it? It's going to be stuff that you need to take on.
Nah.
Maybe things you don't want to hear from time to time.
Again, it was the same. I feel like Steven prepared me to take the next step, to go around Jurgen and his team and to stay there. But I feel like Jurgen and his staff then made me take the next step to then come in a team and play games and stay around the team. So it's always kind of been the same things, but just in a different way. I feel like Steven was more like, look, this is what you're going to need to get there. You've got this, you've got that, it'll get you there, but you're going to have to do this. And then Jurgen was the one that was giving me the opportunities, and then he would call me in his office, say, look, I love how you're doing this, but this is what we need from you. And he'd be show, and like, there'd been times when like, he was showing me clips, look, we need to do this, and then he would show me clips of like how Henderson would go and press there, or Van Alden would do this, and I was looking at it like, not really my game, am I meant to do this? But again, that was the basics of what he wants from you, and I feel like it was super important that like I just took it on board quick, and I learned it, and I gained his trust, and I feel I'm at a point now to where he understands, okay, cool, we can bring him on if the team is getting beat, because we know he can pop up with a goal, or he can create something, or he can start in a big game, because we know we'll get from is going to be this hard work, he will go and press. If like the other team is on top, he'll want the ball still, he's not scared and stuff. So I feel like I've gained his trust and stuff. But again, as I say, you know, I've still got a long way to go. Yeah, I'm on 100 games, but I feel it's just a bit beginning, and I want to just carry on the whole of the form and just keep it going.
We love to pigeonhole football. Is this one for you, Jan, almost to direct in Curtis' direction? Where do you see him as a legacy player at Liverpool? Is he this, is he that? Well, what do you see him being maybe in 2-3 years' time?
No, I don't think he is this or that. Is that right? I mean, I think you're capable of playing in all three midfield positions.
Yeah, definitely.
You could play as a six because you're a press-resistant midfielder, aren't you? I mean, good with the ball and whatever. But I just think that something's just happened in the last 6 or 8 months, isn't it? Like, kind of lends me towards that you're now ready to play in any position, you're ready to play any way we want to play. Like you mentioned before, not every game's going to be the same tactics, is it? Yeah. You seem capable of handling it all.
Yeah.
And I think that's really, really impressive.
I appreciate that, thank you so much.
No, but it must give you a good feel, isn't it? I mean,
nah, yeah, it does. And then hearing it off a man yourself, like you know, is a legend yourself. No, but and I obviously think a player the same. It's,
sometimes you look at players and you go, you know, where's he heading or whatever. And I just think, you know, in the last 6 months. So I just want to come back to that. You played the back end of last season, and then in the summer you go and you win the under-21s with England, and then we decide to buy a brand new midfield. Liverpool, you know, eventually we bring in four brand new midfield players. How did that make you feel? Did you think, wow, I've got to do it all over again now? Or is that expected anyway? You have to be on it every day.
I expect it anyway. Yeah, both. I feel, okay, I've got to do it again with a newer team and a different type of team. But yeah, I expect it anyway. That's not what I mean. It's, you know, at the end of the day, it's Liverpool. So, you know, over me, if 15 to 20 years or however long I'm here, it's always going to be the same. Do you know what I mean? We're always going to attract the stars. The team is always going to want more. The club is always going to want more. And that was also a thing of why I knew, okay, I'm going to come into the team. I'm going to stamp the mark here for the season that's coming up. I'm going to let the fans know. I'm going to let the players who stay know, of course. I'm going to let the staff know, like, look, I'm ready to be part of this team as well. We always knew they were going to bring in lads, and lads were going to go. That's just part of the game. But I didn't want to be a lad again who's just around the team because he's around the team. I want to be a lad who's in the team and I'm playing in the team and give everything that I can. And that's what I'm trying to do. But yeah, as you say in there, yeah, like, you know, I had the 40, we had, okay, the lads coming in and it's a fresh start. But again, though, my confidence was high because, you know, in the back end of the season, the summer that I had. So, you know, I was coming in on air a high, and I'm happy that they're here. Even though that I'm battling against them, I'm picking up on the things that they're doing well as well, and I'm adding it into my game. So at the same time, it was like, okay, I'm battling it all, but at the same time, it's a learning curve as well.
What is this game capable of? Competing with the best?
100%. I'm not just saying it because I'm here, you know. I think, as you know, it's I'm honest at the same time. I think, yeah, we can compete with the best, but we need to change. Like I'm saying now, like, this team can compete with the best. I'm talking about lads who can score from range, can score in the box, who are going to go and press, who are going to go and run, who are going to give everything to the team. And that's not just one or two lads, that's the whole of the team. You look on that, Mo, he scores 20 plus a season, and he's sprinting back. You know what I mean? He's helping out Trent, he's helping out Dom, who's came in. I feel like Dom is doing well as well because he's got Mo in his ear saying, look, you don't need to always pass me the ball, go and shoot, be yourself. And then you've got the likes of Trent behind him saying to go and press. The same with me, if I come in a team, it's like, and like I'm playing in a team, it's like you've got these lads who are just, I don't know what it is about this team, it's just giving everything, you know what I mean? And it's a confidence as well, though, to where, like, we know as well, look, if we play our best, there's not many teams that can get anywhere near us. And that's in terms of keeping the ball. And if you want to turn it into a dog's game or a scrappy game to see you want it more than us, nah, I don't think that's going to happen.
So you and Harvey Elliott sort of came through at the same time, and I guess you've been through almost all of it together.
Yeah, I mean, as an academy lad, or you know, if you're coming out of the academy, I think it's always harder anyway. And Harvey was a lad who came in, and I was young, but he was really young. Mm. And yet he'd had the experience of you play like a couple of games in the championship. And I was on the journey to where the first team and stuff. But of course, you know, I was training every week, but then my games I was going to play was going to be with like the 23s and stuff. So Harvey was a lad who came in, and I could see that he wanted the same thing as me. And it was like, stick together. You know what I mean? So like, let's go out here. And we both knew, look, we have to be the best ones in every single game that we play. Because, okay, cool, we're going to train all the time with the first team, but we're going to come down and the pressure's on us. Okay, they're the ones who are around the first team, so they're the ones who are going to come down. They need to be the ones to set the example and be the leaders. And he helped me out a lot. So kind of have like a healthy competition to where like he came in and like, I knew, okay, I've got a battle again. Like, you've got to come into the team, but I've already been here for the longest. I'm going to show I'm still a main one. He's going to show he's still a main one. And we just made like a, it was half like he was like me little bro, like the whole time. You know what I mean? It's still like that now, but in the academy, it was like a different thing to where like, and the respect was always there, and he was always trying to assist me. I was always trying to assist him, and we always knew that it's a together thing. That's what we need to do. Like, it's not just all about me. It's not just all about you, or you can't just have the ball and just go on, because it will never work. But if this whole team can see that we have this good bond and we play together, then we can just like build the team around us, and that's what we did. And it's still even like now when he goes and plays, and he shows his ability and how much of like a young starting star he is. Like, still now I smile when I say it, because again, is I feel like his journey's similar with me. I feel like he's came in a team, but it's not always just being like a perfect run. He's always had the up and downs. He's helped the squad at times, and he's had his injuries, of course, in the back of a time when he was playing all the games. And then it's kind of like starting all over again. Okay, cool, I've got to come back into the team. I've got to train well. I've got to get back into the team. I've got to stay in the team. And that's the hardest thing. And you know, if he was here now, he'd say the exact same thing. Like, our journeys are like almost the same. And I'm proud of him. He's proud of me. And we're in this together. And, you know, he's going to be a big part of our team.
I was finding funny the amount of foreign players who don't speak much English that you're mates with as well. You mentioned Cody before, you're very close.
Yeah.
Big Darwin.
I call him Gachas, though. Well. That's what we need to call him, Gachas, and that's the name that needs to stick with him. It's not Cody. It's not Cody Gachbo. It's Gachas.
Where's that come from? Obviously his surname, but is there something behind it?
Nah. It was more just Cody just came in. I don't know what it was about him. Like, everybody just loved him when like he came in. He's like the most polite lad, but he's hilarious. And there was a time when like he was going on about my accent. Why is it always dead strong? He was like, because like he was saying to the Verge, I think it was, or like a few of the lads, he was saying like, I can understand Trent because he will speak slow. He said, but with cases, his accent's strong. I said to him, shut up, you gachers. Like, that to him was like a joke. And then from then it just stuck. So like I used to see him and like, what's happening, gachers? Gachers this, gachers that. And he loves it. Like, you know. Yeah, I mean, like his accent and that he drives, he was hilarious. But yeah, I mean, it's the same, like Darwin and that. Yeah, they come in, and I think the fans think that they can't speak English at all. I mean, they've got a little bit, but I feel like the more shy to like show it unless you're actually around them the whole time. So they see me as like a joker at the same time. So like I'll be telling them like the wrong things to say to people. It goes, yeah, if you want to speak to him, you need to say, I'll be telling him the wrong thing to say, or I'll be trying to say,
this has always gone on, hasn't it,
with a Scouse accent.
Yeah, I'll tell you what the problem is, yeah. We arrive, we think we can speak English.
Yeah.
Until we arrive in that dressing room, and then there's...
Do you know what I will say, though? Yeah. And I've been trying to ask them this, but I don't think they really understand what I'm trying to say. I find it mad how yous will pick up on accents of us. So like when the Spanish lads speak to me, it just sounds the same. If the Portuguese lads speak, it would just sound the same. Okay, they're speaking Portuguese, speaking Spanish, they're speaking whatever they're gonna speak, French. How can you tell that our accents are different?
I'm not sure how it works, but I can guarantee one thing that works is that all the English you've been taught in school before you come here, you kind of throw it out of the window the moment you walk into a dressing room full of Scousers. I can assure you of that, isn't it? But,
you know, you are one now.
Yeah, but it doesn't do anyone any harm.
No, you are one now.
Anyway. Tell us about Everton then, FA Cup. That must have meant the world to you.
Yeah, it did. I mean, it still gets brought up now, as you're saying, then. I feel that everybody's forgot I've actually scored more goals than just that one, actually. Because that's the one that always comes, of course, yeah, it's the best goal. I won't take it away. But yeah, again, I'll go back to just being like a young kid in the streets and you're playing football and that. If you can imagine anything that you do, you always think like, I'm going to score like a goal in school, in like primary school and that. You're always thinking, you know, it was against Everton. Then yeah, okay, cool. Now I've got them in the cup and he will change his team around the bin to give lads the opportunity and fresh legs and that. And I was starting. And the only thing I had in my head is like, okay, yeah, I know I'm going to have a good game because I keep the ball, I don't need to do anything. What I'm going to go and do, I'm going to score. I didn't imagine it to actually be like that, but I just added in my head, like, I have to score. And to score, you only go in the game. And yeah, it's something that's like, you know, if you can write a thing as a kid that you want to do in, like, a dream, that's what you would write, you know what I mean, as a Scouse kid. I want to score the winning goal against Everton to knock them out of the club, and it's the first goal for the club, and all things like that. I just feel like it was just a dream, and hopefully there's many more to come.
Yeah, you said it was mad. it must have been mad in the next sort of 24, 48 hours, isn't it, where everybody, well, now everybody knows who Curtis Jones
everybody
is.
Everybody knew me, yeah, from them, but it's mad because everybody would have thought, like, I was going home to a big house, and I went back to my mum's house. I chilled in my mum's house with a cup of tea.
Yes.
Chilling, and we just spoke about the game.
And you couldn't believe it?
Yeah, we couldn't believe it. It was half, like, my mad and proper scousing. Like, that's why I'm still the way I am, it's all because of her. And you could see she was buzzing, but she tries not overly show and show it because she wants me to still do it and do well in that. Do you want a cup of tea? Do you want a biscuit? Do you want to? Now we sat down, we just spoke about it for the whole night. And yeah, of course, I'm not really big on Instagram. I don't really like to go on Instagram. I've got Instagram, but I'm not always on there. And it's been like the first time when I couldn't really let go off Instagram, just to, like, the people who were texting me, the and the pages and all that were posting the whole thing, and about everyone thought he's whatever he's doing. I was actually back at my ma's also, I was just chilling on the couch with a cup of tea, and we just speaking about it with a big smile on our faces, and that's probably the highlight of my career up to now, I'd say.
Does it better when you put the armband on, you lead the team out? I just wonder how that compares with scoring a goal in a derby.
Yeah, I mean,
seismic moment in your life as well.
Yeah, it's different. But yeah, it's definitely up there, because at the end of the day, I mean, I think your ultimate goal is to captain the team. And that doesn't matter if you're a scouser or not, or you're here. It could mean, you know, you could play for any club. But if you're the captain of the club, you know what I mean, you just get a different sort of feeling. So the fact that, you know, that I've captained the team twice, yeah, that's another one, 100%.
Got a couple of quick fire questions for you in a second. This is your chance to put a rally call out, though, because when we had Trent a couple of weeks ago, we were asking whether you need a song now. You know, the Scouser in our team. Do you need a song of your own? Would you like one?
I mean, I've heard my name sang around, and I'd like a song. Like, I'm not going to sit here and lie. Yeah, I'd like a song. But I've seen things saying about, like, the Scouser in our team, we need to change that song. That can't be... Like, that's being Trent's song. Like, I wouldn't want that to change just because now I'm in a team where I'm doing well. I even sing it to Trent, the Scouser in our team. It's like a joke. And I wouldn't want to be involved in Trent's song. I feel that Trent is in. He's coming to the team. He's been unbelievable since he's ever come in. And he's earned the right. And he got that song when I went around the team. But yeah, I'd like my own song, yeah. So I'll see what they come up with.
Get to work. Quick fire questions then. Here we go. First player's name you had on the back of your shirt, who was it?
Steven Gerrard, defo.
Yeah. How do you switch off from football?
Family time.
Cup of tea, biscuit.
Cup of tea, biscuit, me Mars.
Other sports people you take inspiration from? Are you into other sports?
Yeah, basketball, I'm big on basketball. Like, you can tell, you can speak with any of the lads. I always say to them, look, if you want to beat me at pens, that's fine. Just come inside there, I've got a hoop, let's be on basketball. Big one, Michael Jordan, Kobe, and then players now, I'd say Steph Curry is a big one.
Is there something in particular you take from basketball that you can maybe apply to your own profession? Or?
Yeah, I mean, there's a load of things. Of course, it's in a different way, but like the ones that are named then, so example, like, so Curry, for example, like, I've watched certain things on him where he was saying he'd always suffer with doing his ankles and things like that. So how much hard work that he put in, like, behind the scenes to keep himself fit and keep himself on the court. And then, of course, he's changed the whole of the game. And it's not all about just the stuff that you do on the pitch. There's so much off the pitch to keep yourself actually on the pitch, to like play games that you've got to do, and the recovery part of things and the gym, and just getting the most out of yourself.
Your car breaks down, which teammate do you call for help?
Gachas. Cody. Yeah.
Is he handy?
I'll just phone him. I would just phone him. Yeah. Cody or Trent.
Yeah.
Cody or Trent.
Selections. And a half serious one to finish, I suppose. Which teammate's been the biggest influence on you since getting into the senior side? You've mentioned quite a few of them. Is there one that kind of sticks out?
There's a few in so many different ways. I would say two and not even now would be Hendo and Millie. I think they were the biggest. But the ones that are still here now, I would say Alisson's helped me a lot. And I'd say Trent. Ali and Trent. I say them two, definitely.
You mentioned James Milner as a great influence on your career. And during lockdown, when there was no fans inside the stadiums, I was fortunate enough to be at all the games. And it was quite incredible the amount of coaching he used to do, because you could hear him.
Yeah.
He just never, ever shut up, did he?
Nah.
And you know, when he was shouting at you, it was all about awareness and, you know, don't knock off, you know, be sharp.
That's exactly what it is. And I couldn't believe it at first when I first came around it. Of course, you'd always known about, the senior ones will always help and will always be a vocal ones, always talk loads and help out the kids and lead the team and that. But Millie just had a different brain. The knowledge that he has is just it's frightening. I remember the time when he pulled me aside and he was always saying about the ability and that I've got, and but how much hard work that I've got to do. And then even the times when we'll call it telling off, but the times when he's been on me case a bit, and it helped me out loads. But then to me, it was more just the respect thing as well, in terms the career that he's had and how young he was, and he's come all the way through, and the fact that he was still there any time that you need him to come on and play, or to start a game and go and play, he would be there. And he would, one, he'd either run the most, or two, he would shout the most. And he was always around the team and stuff, the changing rooms, you could put him on right wing, striker, and centre mid, or anywhere in a defensive line. He would just give everything he's got. Even though he had that name and he knew of how many games that he had played, just how good he was with the whole of the lads was just, it was unbelievable. And it weren't he would tell off a young kid, but he was scared. Well, not telling off, I say telling off, but he would have a go at a young kid. But he would do exactly the same thing with a senior lad, as you say. So it was it was the respect that I had as well at the same time, he's on my back, but he's also on Trent's back, or he's on Virgil's back, or he's on Hendo's back, and I'm thinking he's doing it with them and he's doing it with me. So I just thought, he's this man. One, he's a serious man, but two, he's a fantastic man as well.
Well, listen, that's us out of time, and really appreciate you sitting down with us. It's been great to get to know you a bit more.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
We wish you the best for the rest of the season and beyond.
Thank you very much.